These drop boxes at Operation Recycle once served as important tools in the fight against waste. But thanks to economic pressure, several local facilities have had to abandon recycling efforts. Thus, the boxes will soon become exactly what they once held, garbage. Ryan Tharp, the director of Operation Recycle, explains.
St. Luke's Church closed about 3 weeks ago. And what that did does is all the people that have been recycling, or a lot of them, started bringing their material over here, and it just overwhelmed us. We just couldn't handle it all.
The result was per month losses in excess of $1,000 at Operation Recycle. Overall, the loss of the St. Luke's facility more than doubled the amount of material brought there. St. Luke's pastor Mark Hamner says that his church's move was unfortunate, but ultimately necessary.
Over the course of the last year, though, the price of paper bottomed out, and so we began to be charged for the paper pickup and the hauling, and it just got to be too prohibitive for us to be able to maintain it.
Now, if you're still looking to recycle, you're certainly not out of luck. There are plenty of other centers open in the Bloomington-Normal area. Among them are Chittick's Junior High, the College Hills Mall, the ISU baseball field, and the Normal City Hall. This box may have lost its function at this recycling facility, but it's the residents of Bloomington Normal that may have the most to lose from this decision. For TV-10 News, I'm Jack McDonald.
There are people around the world who are vigorously attacking this disease. We're getting closer, but we're not close enough.
With those words this morning, Illinois Wesleyan professor Wayne Dornan accepted a $5,000 grant for research into Alzheimer's disease. The grant was awarded by the Corn Belt chapter of the Alzheimer's Association, which has been fighting the disease locally for 14 years. Mark Carlin, the chapter's executive director, explains how his chapter has helped fight this dreaded disease.
We assist those caregivers at home in different ways that we're able to teach them how they might be able to better give care, help reduce some of that kind of stress. We're able to give education. We're able to bring more awareness about this particular disease to the community itself.
The money will be used to research the pathological process of a gene called the ApoE gene. Dornan feels Alzheimer's may be induced by abnormal production of this gene within the brain. He showed me slides of brain tissue from two patients. The first sample didn't have Alzheimer's and looked like a plain green mass. The other had the disease and was covered with white speckles. Those speckles were the ApoE gene, and as Dornan explains,
that gene, when it is abnormally processed, leads to a proliferation of this protein in the brain that, I guess it's the old story, too much is a bad thing.
Dornan said he hopes to get more research grants in the near future. With over 4 million Americans currently suffering from Alzheimer's disease, it's easy to understand why. For TV-10 News, I'm Jack McDonald. Music fans of all ages are awaiting the arrival of John Tesh this weekend. However, these local musicians are a little more anxious than most. 20 students from North Point Elementary School will join Tesh on stage this Sunday at ISU's Braden Auditorium. The 5th and 6th graders will accompany Tesh for one song. Donna Statshold has been training the students, and she explains how the project came about.
I got a call from the music shop this summer asking if I had a children's choir that would be willing to perform on the program.
From there, the choir members themselves had to be selected. According to Statshold, there was no shortage of applicants for the unique opportunity.
Well, I asked all my 5th and 6th graders who would like to perform, and I had 55 children sign up. So I had to audition all of those, and we had 20. I chose 20 from that then.
The students themselves are looking forward to their moment in the spotlight, although they told me Tesh isn't quite their favorite musician.
Oh, we had no clue who you are.
My parents used to watch Entertainment Tonight, but that's all.
The concert will begin on Sunday at 7:30, but for the kids involved, it can't get here soon enough. For TV-10 News, I'm Jack McDonald. These stands are empty now, but ISU's homecoming committee is looking to change that by tomorrow's game. There's a little bit of everything planned. A reception tonight in the Bone Student Center Ballroom will kick things off. That'll be followed by a bonfire at 9 o'clock outside Tri Towers, featuring the ISU marching band as well as free food and drinks. Students can also pick up items like these displayed by our very own Gretchen Wirtz. In fact, student involvement has been a focal point of this year's committee, according to organizer Jan Floyd.
We've worked real hard with Jill Benson out of the Office of Student Life and Don Watson, who's the chair of the Student Special Events Committee, and they've gotten a lot of students involved.
Floyd also said that there's plenty of variety in this year's homecoming festivities.
This year there is something for everyone in Homecoming 96, and we really want to see everybody out tonight and tomorrow to enjoy this 75th anniversary of Homecoming.
Organizers are hoping that this weekend's bonfire will provide the first big spark for this weekend's homecoming activities. For TV-10 News, I'm Jack McDonald. If you own a black cat or have a habit of breaking mirrors, you're probably pretty edgy today. Friday the 13th has long been the black sheep of the calendar year. But did you know that there's actually a disease name for people who fear the number 13? It's called tristidecaphobia. And among other people, it struck such notable figures as Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Herbert Hoover, banker J. Paul Getty, and Napoleon. In fact, tristidecaphobia can be traced all the way back to the beginnings of the Christian religion. But what do ISU students think about it?
Like today, I found it was Friday 13. I got a whole week out for a little while because I seen a psychic before just for fun at a bar, and she freaked the hell out of me. She told me everything, what stuff she went on. So ever since then, I'm pretty superstitious.
All right, you know today's Friday the 13th, don't you?
Yes.
You a little nervous today?
Nope.
Taking extra care not to, you know, break mirrors, walk under ladders, that sort of thing?
Nope. I'm not familiar with tristidecaphobia or tristidecaphobia, however you pronounce that.
As you can see, student opinion on superstition is kind of mixed. I'm not really sure whether I'm superstitious or not, but I think I'll take my chances. For TV-10 News, I'm Jack McDonald. Flowers, candy, people holding hands. These are just some of the common sights each Valentine's Day as people celebrate their relationships. But what's not seen or heard about is what led to the frenzy of flowers we see today. After doing a little research, we set out to see if ISU students could provide us the answer. Or do you have any idea at all how Valentine's Day got started?
I have no clue.
Valentine's Day was started by card companies and flower companies. I have no idea.
Who started this? Does anyone know? Do you know?
As it happens, I do know, and it was the Romans. They had a festival each year in which teenage girls were lotteried off to Roman men. This didn't sit well with the Catholic Church, who felt it was immoral. As we found out, a lot of people feel Valentine's Day is immoral.
It's kind of like Sweetest Day, it's a crack.
I have absolutely no idea how this bogus holiday got started.
This is a superficial holiday that we're celebrating.
It sucks.
That, in a nutshell, is what Bishop Valentine felt about Roman policy. Emperor Claudius II banned marriages, saying it kept men from joining the army. Valentine was jailed and executed for performing marriages, but before he died, he left a note for his lover that read, "Farewell from your Valentine." The name stuck, and over time, his simple message blossomed into the greeting card explosion that so offended the people we talked to. Fortunately, we did meet some people who saw a purpose in celebrating February 14th.
It's okay. I think I would be a little more excited, you know, if I had someone in my life or whatever, but it's no big deal if I don't, but I think people, like, freak out about it too much.
I love Valentine's Day. I was telling him from the time I was the tiniest kid.
As you can tell, this person at least certainly appreciates the Valentine's Day spirit, and though a lot of people that we've talked to have been kind of bitter about it, I think deep down they really appreciate the spirit of Valentine's Day. For TV-10 News, I'm Jack McDonald. Coming off last year's 29-win season, the ISU volleyball team opened this season on the road with high expectations. But after winning just one of their first four matches, the Redbirds were more than ready for some home cooking. This weekend's Pepsi ISU Classic pitted the Birds against some formidable opponents from Tulsa, Murray State, and California. Even before the tourney began, Coach Julie Morgan knew the Birds were in for a battle.
Tulsa's gone into the WAC this past year, and they now have two new coaches, so I expect them to be a much improved team than the team that we saw in the Missouri Valley. Murray State is notoriously a competitive team. Cal Berkeley. Last year we played them at Berkeley, and they were a real young team, but very athletic. Well, they've got a year of experience behind them, and so I would expect that they're going to be one of the favorites in the tournament.
Morgan's predictions would prove accurate, as Cal knocked off both Murray State and Tulsa to advance to the final against Illinois State. The Redbirds had won their first two matches as well, riding the stellar play of freshman Kendra Hazelhorst. But in the final, the Redbirds would be plagued by the inconsistency that had hurt them on the road. ISU rallied to win the first game 15-13, but Cal, behind tourney MVP Jessica Dineberg, won three of the next four games to take the championship.
So Illinois State wins two out of three at home in the Pepsi Illinois State Classic. Not what Coach Julie Morgan and team are hoping for, but certainly an improvement over the beginning of their season. For TV-10 Sports, I'm Jack McDonald.
Her given name is Kendra Marie Hazelhorst, and off the court, she's a soft-spoken freshman. But for those who have seen the 6'1 middle blocker play, only one name is appropriate.
The Viking, I don't know where it came from.
She's not from Minnesota, and she doesn't play football. No, that nickname comes from her aggressive play for the ISU volleyball team. She's already won MVC Player of the Week honors and been a key ingredient in the team's 8-0 conference start. But the nickname Viking came before any of that. Actually, according to head coach Julie Morgan, it came the first week of the season.
It was actually the media in Hawaii that picked it up. We played Hawaii that night, and Kendra was just, you know, doing her thing and, you know, pretty much holding her own against some of the veteran Hawaii players. And the media picked up on that and told me that they had felt that Kendra's nickname should be the Viking.
That nickname, as well as the style of play that inspired it, have stuck with Hazelhorst. As she explains, you don't need to be thinking like a warrior to play like one.
Just stay focused in the game. Just stay in the game. Being aggressive helps me stay in the game and concentrate. I mean, I just go out there and I have my goals, like my personal goals, you know, to hit well or to block well, and I just think about that while I'm out there.
It's been a rapid rise to success for this freshman out of Evanston, Illinois. You can call her the Viking, you can call her whatever you want to, but one thing you have to call her is a success. For TV-10 Sports, I'm Jack McDonald. To the casual observer, today's basketball media day looked, well, like last year's media day. With the exception of Tyrese Bryson, this year's cast is merely last year's with a little more age. Of course, at this time last year, there was no MVC championship to defend, no expectations of NCAA success, and notably less attention from the national polls. To put it another way, pressure, a noun, is defined as the burden of physical or mental distress. But is there another definition? Kevin Stallings doesn't seem to think so.
It's really no different than going in to last year, except for the fact that we'll be the hunted a lot more than we were last year because of our success last year. And again, that happens when you raise the bar a little bit, and fortunately we've been able to do that.
The team seems relaxed as well. You might think that high national rankings and a tougher schedule would strike some fear into the Redbirds, but Stallings says it's just not so.
We've always been a very determined team, and if we have that kind of determination, that kind of competitiveness that we've shown in the past, and that grows as it should when you become a senior and you experience that sense of urgency with what comes with your last season, then I think we'll be fine.
Coming off a 24-win season and a berth in the NCAA tournament, you might think this team would be facing a lot more pressure than they were a year ago. But it's a veteran team, and Coach Kevin Stallings clearly has them prepared so that the only pressure involved in their game will be the pressure they put on the opposing teams. For TV-10's...
If winning Missouri Valley Conference matches is the ISU volleyball team's business, then business is definitely good. Dating back to last season, Julie Morgan's squad has won 27 of their last 28 conference battles, losing only to Indiana State at the end of a 5-match road swing. Having weathered that storm, the Birds return to Redbird Arena for 3-game sweeps of Creighton and Drake. You'd think they'd have earned a rest, right?
On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again.
Wrong. Friday, they again hit the road, this time with a chance to lock up another Missouri Valley Conference title.
The Redbirds may seem to be living a Willie Nelson song, but they'll have enough on their minds without worrying about homesickness. They'll be facing a Northern Iowa team that needs to win this match to have any chance of dethroning the Redbirds.
The match promises to be a dogfight. In their first meeting, ISU prevailed in four hard-fought games. Add home court advantage to Northern Iowa's hunger for revenge, and suddenly Coach Julie Morgan's concerns are well-grounded.
I don't think Northern Iowa's doing anything different than when we played them last. They're just playing better, and they play better at their own facility as well. They have a definite home court advantage, so we're just going to work on being able to execute for long periods of time because I think it'll be a long match.
The Redbirds will really be racking up those frequent driver miles over the remainder of their season, but it's certainly for a good cause. With wins this weekend, they can just about assure themselves of their second straight Missouri Valley Conference title. Jack McDonald, TV-10 Sports.
It's just silly to beat around the bush here. The ISU volleyball team could not be in a better position. You need proof? Well, I've got it. They've won the Missouri Valley Conference 2 years running. They've got Marissa Brickley, the league MVP. They've got Kendra Hazelhorst, the newcomer of the year, and also a first-team MVC selection. And they're hosting the MVC tournament, which kicks off tonight. If that's not enough proof for you, there's a couple of juries you need to be on. Add to that the fact that the only team to beat the Birds, Indiana State, will face a more talented Creighton team in the first round. That's quite a Christmas list, what with it only being November and all. But nonetheless, ISU head coach Julie Morgan managed to keep a straight face while previewing this weekend's tournament.
Anytime you can play a tournament in your own home, you know, you definitely have an advantage, and I know we feel like we have a home court advantage.
But before you go polishing up that trophy, remember this. Indiana State is a team that this year has knocked off each of the top three seeds in the tournament. And Southwest Missouri State has the top two leaders in kills per game average in the Missouri Valley Conference. So though ISU may be expected to have an easy ride into the NCAA tournament, this is one gift horse that Julie Morgan and company will look squarely in the mouth. Jack McDonald, TV-10 Sports.
Jack McDonald's in with our sports. Jack, I hear another Redbird got recognized in the Valley today.
Certainly have. Corrine Vossel had a couple great games last week. Missouri Valley Conference Player of the Week this week.
Good for her.
ISU senior forward Corrine Vossel has been named the Missouri Valley Player of the Week after leading the Birds in a pair of games last week. Vossel scored 43 points and grabbed 29 rebounds against Michigan and San Francisco. Her 25 points against the Wolverines were a career high, as were her 15 rebounds against San Fran. She capped off that game with a buzzer-beating three-pointer, giving the Birds a double overtime victory.
Well, it's a great accomplishment, but a lot of the congratulations has to go with my team, too. I mean, they're the ones that get me the ball and stuff in a lot of situations, so.
Vossel and the Birds open their home season against Wisconsin on Saturday. Having conquered the Missouri Valley Conference, the ISU volleyball team is heading for national pastures. The Redbirds will leave tomorrow for Texas to take on South Carolina. It'll be the first matchup between the two teams. The Gamecocks enter the tournament at 20-7. At a press conference today, Coach Julie Morgan stressed that though the team has reached many of its goals, they're far from satisfied.
The ultimate goal for everybody, I believe, at ISU is to get a team to win at the second round level and get into the regional. So although, you know, you don't look past that goal, we're very close to getting it. Our goal wasn't just to win the Missouri Valley.
Should they win, the Redbirds will face the winner of 13th-ranked Texas and Stephen F. Austin. The Green Bay Packers woke up today with something only the 49ers have in the NFC, and that's 10 victories. The Pack earned that, along with the Central Division lead, by defeating the Vikings last night in Minnesota. The Pack won 27-11. It was Mike Holmgren's first win in Minnesota in 6 years. Brett Favre threw for 196 yards, and Dorsey Levens added 108. The Packers head to Tampa Bay next week, while the Vikings are hosted by San Francisco. Have you ever felt like choking your boss? Oh, you have too, don't lie to me. But you haven't done it, which sets you well apart from Golden State's Latrell Sprewell. The All-Star guard has been suspended for at least 10 games after choking and throwing a punch at head coach P.J. Carlissimo. Sprewell reportedly balked at Carlissimo's instructions at a team shoot-around and then attacked when the coach approached him. The two have been feuding since Carlissimo took over in October. Sprewell currently leads the 1-13 Warriors with 21 points per game.
All right, Jack, thanks.
Thank you.
When TV-10 continues.
Welcome back. The Chicago Bulls will have home court advantage throughout the playoffs.
Just as surprisingly, the sun rose in the east today. The Bulls knocked off the upstart 76ers last night, 128-102, and now we have to show you how. Well, they're always happy to see Michael at the United Center. Why is that, you might ask? Could be because he hits from short, and he hits from long. And also, he makes an utter mockery of the league by making shots like this. Mike has 30 on the night. Equally non-surprising was Allen Iverson's 44 points, but when you take 32 shots, that's not difficult. Here, look, he doesn't pass, he hits a three. That's not difficult. Now, that's 66 wins for the Bulls, which is more than the Sixers have had combined in several seasons. The only goal left now for Chicago is the 72 wins they compiled last season. Oh, and the championship tip. The Chicago Cubs went into today's home opener with the Marlins as the worst team in all of baseball. The six games into the season, questions are being raised as to whether they'll even match the Bulls' number of victories. Seeing as the Marlins are responsible for three of their six losses already, it didn't look rosy for the Northsiders going in. You could even tell that from the weather. Gary Sheffield quickly poured some acid rain on the Cubs' parade by sending this Steve Traxel pitch into orbit. It was Sheffield's first home run of the year, and it gave Florida a 1-0 lead in the first inning. But not for long. In the second inning, Sammy Sosa lit into this offering from Al Leiter, tying up the score. It was Sosa's first of the year as well. Leiter would later walk Sosa with the bases loaded to put the Cubs ahead, but Charles Johnson would ruin all that with this two-run double in the seventh inning that put Florida ahead for good. Cubs went on to lose the game 5-3 and fall to 0-7 in what equals their worst start in their 121-year history. The hapless Cubs will try to put an end to that on Thursday when they again face the Marlins at Wrigley Field. A strange story today from the Houston Astros camp. Right-hander Pete Harnisch has been placed on the disabled list because of insomnia. Harnisch was supposed to pitch against the Giants on Sunday, but did not sleep the night before. He said he was dead tired, but unable to fall asleep. The problem is believed to be related to the recent end of his 13-year chewing tobacco habit. Harnisch also said that his recent troubles reminded him of the Lyme disease he contracted while recovering from surgery in 1995. No word yet on when Harnisch might return to active duty. The Masters will be getting underway on Thursday, and for one man, it'll be a chance for redemption. No, not that guy with the John 3:13 sign, Greg Norman. The Shark will try to make us all forget about his collapse at last year's Masters. By now, it's common knowledge that golf's greatest underachiever blew a 6-stroke lead on the final day and lost to Nick Faldo. In fact, Norman is the first to tell you that he's heard quite enough about last year's rotten final round performance.
I mean, like I said, it's been a great story. A lot of people have written about it for a long period of time, 52 weeks, maybe 361 days. I don't know what the exact time is, but I think that story is, it's run its course, I think. And, you know, I want to create other stories. What those other stories are, I don't know. But leave this one die. It's over and done with.
The first round will kick off Thursday afternoon. The crowd should be a story in itself. Besides Norman, defending champion Nick Faldo will be appearing along with 20-year-old phenom Tiger Woods. Well, tonight will be a sad one in Pittsburgh. Longtime Penguin star Mario Lemieux will play his final home game tonight against Boston. The 31-year-old Lemieux formally announced his retirement this week, although he's acknowledged it all season. He's on track to win his sixth scoring title this season, but has paid a tremendous physical toll in the process. Rampant back problems and a battle with Hodgkin's disease finally convinced Lemieux to hang up his skates. At a press conference today, Lemieux said that he hopes his finale will be a successful one.
I have a couple games in the playoffs, a few games, I hope, and you're right, you never know when the last game's going to be. It might be on the road, might be at home, so that's something that we're going to have to wait and see, but hopefully I'd like to finish my last game at home.
Take Lemieux out of it, and that game tonight is rather meaningless otherwise. The Penguins have already clinched the playoff berth while the Bruins are polishing up their golf clubs. And finally tonight, sometimes hockey fights get a little personal. The two gentlemen you see fighting here are Keith and Wayne Primo, and yes, they're brothers. It seems Wayne hit Keith's goalie, and Keith don't much like that. This is a scene straight out of my family reunions, for crying out loud. Keith, the older, bigger brother, will eventually beat his brother down, which, sadly, is also right out of my family reunion. Briefly tonight, Mike Tyson has postponed his fight with Evander Holyfield because of a cut over his left eye. That fight will be held June 28th. And that's all I've got for you in sports today. Don't go away. Tina will be right back with your weather recap when we return. Welcome back. So far this season, it's been a quaint form of self-abuse to be a Cub fan. They're 0-10, the worst start in league history, and went into today's showdown with the Colorado Rockies with no regulars batting over 200. Kevin Foster took the hill for the Cubs. That's the same Kevin Foster who's a flyball pitcher pitching against a home run happy club in a small park with the wind blowing out. You do the math. It was a 3-2 game when Dante Bichette came up in the third inning, and Foster promptly gave Bichette a 360-foot tour of the infield with a hanging curve, the end result of which was a 4-2 Colorado lead. The Cubs would fight back, though. Brooks Kieschnick took this Mark Johnson offering over the wall to bring the Cubs within a run, but then the Cubs' bats went cold as they lose 10-7 and fall to 0-11 on the season. The White Sox were in Texas last night trying to abandon the American League cellar. They didn't. After Tony Phillips doubled in the third inning, this single by Ray Durham put the Sox up 1-0. But the Rangers would tie things up in the bottom half of the inning, and it would remain that way until the eighth inning when Rusty Greer blasted this two-run homer to give the Rangers a 3-1 victory. The Sox are now 3-8 on the season.
Welcome back. We're in with Jack McDonald. Jack, I heard Todd Kurth had a wonderful birthday this past weekend.
Yes, they were saying that he had a tough choice between the teams deciding.
He basically came down to Atlanta and Minnesota, and he went with the Vikings.
Wonderful.
Sunday signified the second day of the NFL draft, but it was also ISU kicking phenom Todd Kurth's birthday. Todd's big gift with the NFL did not come on draft day. Instead, his present was a day late. TV-10's Mark Louderman has more.
Illinois State's all-time leading kicker for TV-10 Sports.
It was a busy day in baseball yesterday. The Chicago Cubs won their second game in a row, prompting cries of break up the Cubs. On the other side of town, Tony Phillips flipped his lid. Phillips was batting and bickering with umpire John Schulock in the first inning. After Schulock ordered Yankee starter David Cone to throw the ball, Phillips hits this foul ball and explodes. Phillips apparently thought he was at the post office, attacking Schulock and getting ejected. It would end up costing the White Sox dearly. The seesaw game remained close until the eighth inning when Cecil Fielder broke a tie with this double. In the ninth inning, Mariano Rivera came in and used his 90-mile-an-hour-plus fastball to shut the door on the White Sox. Overall, the series was one of utter futility. Both teams remain in last place in their divisions. The New York Yankees today bolstered their shaky relief corps. They've acquired Japanese pitcher Hideki Irabu and three minor leaguers for two players and $3 million. Irabu is proving he'll have no problem fitting into the world of American sports. He's already mastered the technique of whining until you get what you want. You may recall that Irabu demanded a trade to the Yankees in spring training. The San Diego Padres held his rights, but he refused to play for them. While it is understandable that anyone would want to leave the Padres, this trade is just another example of the problems in Major League Baseball. Once Irabu learns how to spit on umpires, his conversion to the American game will be complete. And speaking of spitting, there will be an interesting reunion of sorts in Baltimore tonight. Umpire John Hirschbeck will be working the Baltimore game, at which Roberto Alomar will also be present. By now, you've seen the video of their last meeting 100 times. Well, make it 101. This fine, saliva-filled performance earned Alomar a little more than some minor irritation around the wrists. He got a 5-game suspension, which was conveniently delayed until this season, so that he could play in the playoffs and draw big ratings. That suspension is over, and the two will meet for the first time tonight. Both sides have said that they have put the incident behind them and are not expecting any trouble. The Pittsburgh Penguins moved to within one loss of golf season last night. The Pens lost 5-3 to fall an 0-3 in their series. Perhaps they'd have a chance if they were playing the Cubs, but it's the Philadelphia Flyers on the other side of the ice. It was 2-1 in the second period, and then Eric Lindros got the puck, and then it was 2-2. Lindros, John LeClair, and Michael Renberg combined for 3 goals and 7 assists in the game. After the game, Lindros said that the win was really more of a team effort.
Of course, I mean, we're getting goals from everybody, and that's a huge, huge part of playoff success, and it's got to continue.
Game 4 of that series will take place tomorrow in Pittsburgh. A dark note today from the world of professional football. Former Chicago Bear Lars Tate was shot this morning as he attempted to stop a fight between a couple. Tate was shot in the neck and is listed in critical condition at this hour. Police have a suspect in custody. Tate played for the Bears for part of one season after a couple seasons with Tampa Bay. A pinched nerve ended his playing career in 1990. And finally tonight, this Bear-Packer rivalry has really gotten out of hand. Take a look at this. The man you see with the suitcase is former Bear Steve McMichael. The man that attacks him is current Green Bay Packer Reggie White. See, Reggie doesn't want Steve to hit his friend with the suitcase. His friend is oblivious because he's beating up the other man in the ring.
Of course, even though it's wrestling, there's a bit of realism. Green Bay came out on top. And that's all we've got for you. Oh, briefly tonight, the ISU women's golf team has won the MVC championship by 13 strokes. Julie Orison is the individual champion, and Tracy Jerf has been named coach of the year. It's the team's first such title in 4 years, and ISU now has 8 MVC titles overall this year. Don't go away. Tina Elliott will be right back with the weather recap when we return. Football operations in the Big Easy have officially become the domain of Mike Ditka. The New Orleans Saints selected the former Chicago Bears head man today to revive the struggling franchise. You may remember Ditka from his tenure in Chicago.
I don't know if we're capable of winning another football game. I don't think we are at this point. This football team is in disarray.
We think we are absolutely an atrocious football team.
If your job is to do a hatchet job on Jim, do it. Let your guts fall where they may.
You want to get answers to what you need, get them from Red Motley. He's the expert at everything.
At Golden State last night, the Phoenix Suns turned into Jason Kidd and the Kidettes. First, he makes a layup. Then he makes a three-pointer. And he did that a lot. He had 8 of them on the night, which really pleased his coach, Danny Ainge. Well, trust me, he was great. Kentucky fans received an extremely early Christmas gift today. Derek Anderson, who many thought was finished after blowing out a knee 2 months ago, practiced with the team today. Anderson is expected to play in the Wildcats' Sweet 16 matchup with St. Joseph's. Head coach Rick Pitino says that he's flabbergasted by Anderson's quick return.
Because there's any way possible Derek could play. But today, he actually practiced with the team, full out, no holds barred. He was, without question, the best player in practice today. He dominated practice. And if he never left, he was never injured. And quite frankly, in my 22 years of coaching, it's the biggest surprise that Jack I've ever had as a coach.
That game will take place Thursday night. Both teams are coming off of tough victories in the round of 32. Turning now to hockey, there were a couple trades in the NHL today. 13-year veteran Kirk Muller will join the Florida Panthers. In exchange, the Toronto Maple Leafs pick up right winger Jason Podolin. Muller's production has dropped sharply since scoring 94 points in 1993. Also today, the Pittsburgh Penguins picked up Ed Olczyk and Roman Eksuta for Glenn Murray and Richard Park. Murray will go to the LA Kings, and Park will join the Anaheim Mighty Ducks. Some sad news today from the world of college basketball. Former Memphis basketball star Baskerville Holmes and his girlfriend have been found dead in what police are calling a murder-suicide. Holmes and the woman were found dead with gunshot wounds in Memphis this morning. Holmes was a member of the Tigers' 1985 Final Four squad. The bad news is continuing for a 2-time Horse of the Year cigar. The record-setting racehorse has failed miserably at carrying on the family name. After taking 34 unsuccessful rolls in the hay, his owners have filed an infertility claim on a $25 million insurance policy. It requires that Cigar impregnate 12 of 20 mares or be declared infertile. Thankfully, we don't have any of the locker room footage to go with that story. And that's all we've got for you tonight in sports. Tina Elliott will return with our weather recap right after this. Shocking news in the coaching world for the Illinois State men's basketball team. No, Kevin Stallings is not going anywhere, but assistant head coach Jeff Wolburn is. Coach Wolburn announced late yesterday afternoon in a team meeting that he is resigning from the program. Wolburn is planning on starting a family with his wife and getting a job outside of the basketball world in the Bloomington Normal area. According to many team members, Coach Wohl will be missed.
I'm completely beside myself that he left, but you know, I'm proud of him. He's moving on. He's going to start a family soon. I've been with him. Actually, him and Coach Stallings, another guy, and Coach Hurley, were the real reason I came here. So, when, you know, him leaving is a big transition for me. But, you know, I'm glad he did it where I only got 1 year left instead of 2 or 3.
I don't think you guys have enough time to allow me to tell you how much Coach Wohl has meant to myself, my teammates, and in the program.
Probably how personable he was, and just what a nice guy he was, and he was always there, you know, that you could talk to him about, you know, anything, any problems you might have had, you know, off the court. He was always there, and that's what you look for in a coach, you know.
I'm gonna miss him a whole lot because actually he kept me out of a lot of trouble around here. But I mean, he's just like I say, he's real important to me because of the relationship I have with him and the relationship he has with my mother.
How shocking.
That's all we've got for you right now in sports. Stay tuned. Kim will be right back with a weather recap when we return.